Okay, hello Catherine, hello Dorothy.
Hey Dorothy.
Hey Catherine.
Hey Catherine.
Don't want to leave her out. Okay, so all I'm done for today was talking about that there homework. And there were some things that I failed to give you the other day.
I love the implicit instructions. Work alone.
Alone. This is just a sample lesson planner that you might use for teaching lessons. Teaching people other than little ones.
Just this one. I started to try to teach piano, but I'm only doing 10 minutes at the beginning of school.
Well, anyway, so just a little guide, you know, if you, and it comes in handy. I mean, I'm a hard copy paper person. Constanza Roeder, who some of you guys may know, Constanza teaches over at Brandeis. She has some online tools that, I mean, she tracks every single one of her students with these online things, and so it's all up in the cloud, and she's got, you know, okay, Tuesday, these are my students, and then she clicks on her schedule, and there's the lesson plan that she's made for that student and what rep they're working on, and it's amazing. Of course, she has about 45 students, and she has to be that organized. But anyway, so the lesson plan thing. So we're going to talk through these two assigned moms. So why don't we do the vocalese one first? Naturally, there is no chalk. Oh, here it is. Viola. So this is the vocalese number one, which has said pattern. All eighth notes. La, be, da, me, mi, fo, two. And we'll just assume eighth notes. Okay. So, talk to me about the pattern.
So, it's relatively short and mostly descending.
Overall, it kind of descends, yeah.
But it does have some, you know, major thirds and minor thirds skips, so it's a little bit disjunct, which I think.
Down there, yeah. Mm-hmm. Towards the end, there's a little more reeling and rocking going on. Okay. So there's some disjunct, and then there's some conjunct. Sorry. Okay. That's pattern. Anything else you want to say about pattern?
Good, probably for, you know, younger singers who are starting to do things that are more mm-hmm. disjunct and mm-hmm. need more of that coordination.
Yeah. Okay. How about the consonants?
The consonants help with phrasing, so we don't like accent. That we have like more legato going on.
Uh-huh.
And also it helps with not being too breathy. I think those consonant like pit stops help keep the airflow going consistently.
Notice the difference between the ones that are double underlined mm-hmm. and the difference is
voiced
and unvoiced. So you start with a lot of voices, which is getting to the legato idea that you were talking about. Did you look at articulation in terms of the consonants? Think about that.
Yes.
Okay. So what you got?
It kind of goes hand in hand with the whole like accenting, don't accent,
uh-huh.
Just being clear but yet moving through them.
Uh-huh.
It's kind of where I just had it more with the legato
mm-hmm.
addiction.
Also, you want to add anything?
I thought it was
because it's a great mix.
Mm-hmm.
I forget what you call an L. I called it lingual.
Yeah.
But I said there's good. We've got the plosive, both voice and unvoiced. We've got nasals. We've got the lingual. And what's fun about it is a lot of them are focused in the. They're all focused in the front of the mouth.
Exactly.
I think I forgot to write that, but that's something I noticed. They're all focused in the front of the mouth, which keeps even your dark vowels forward.
Mm-hmm. So you've got la, which is tongue, be, which is lips, da, which is tongue, me, which is lips, ni, which is
tongue,
oh.
Ho, which is lips, which is tongue.
Huh.
So you're doing
that.
Tongue and lip and tongue and lip.
Bless you.
Gracious, those were delicate soprano sneezes.
Did I talk about her extension in the paper?
No, but
this little girl who I vocally sent to a G. G. Is that a
six?
G6?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had a student here who could sing F7.
That's nice.
The top F on the piano. And she could sustain the top D on the piano.
Oh
my
God.
D7. She could sustain it. I mean, yeah, it's crazy. It's crazy. So yeah, tongue, lip. And it's nice that you get the voice version, and you get the nasal version, and you get the plosive version, unvoiced plosive. You get the voiced plosive, the nasal, and the unvoiced plosive.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a nice little dance of kinds of consonants. Yeah, I do this one for articulation, making sure that I'm not stopping too much with consonants. All right, let's go back to you on vowels.
That it alternates between dark ah, which is back, and then or I guess technically it's E, right?
Yeah.
So back, front, back,
mm-hmm.
and then front, and then front, and
front and V.
Back. And this alternation helps to not let one or the other.
I will show our colleagues who are not with us. Ta-da! Okay. Yeah, so yeah, you've got a back vowel, a front vowel, a back vowel, then two fronts and two backs. All right. Anything you wanted to add in terms of anything vowel-wise or consonant-wise? Yeah, and that the you know you've got the nasals and they're surrounded by plosives,
mm-hmm.
so if it went down, it gets right back up. Also, anybody talk about the well, like muscle activation kind of stuff? Right, because it's conjunct, so pretty smooth. If you're doing it in this range, exactly where it's written, that's going right over your lower bridge as a woman, or right into your passaggio as a man. I probably wouldn't do this one personally in my passaggio.
I wrote that I would use this primarily in middle and low voice, that the transition in a high would just be...
Oh, yeah, you took it up high, it would be not pretty. So yeah, not to be taken terribly, terribly high, just because you got closed vowels and things like that. Okay, what about the tempo? How fast would you go?
I noted that the no tempo or dynamic markings make this exercise possible.
Yep.
You can decide what you want on a person basis. If you took it some very quick changes.
Oh yeah, it's like
both
a pattern
vowel
song, yeah.
And consonant wise, like moving your tongue that quickly.
Yeah.
It's very challenging.
Let's try it. La ve da me ni po tu.
La ve da me ni po tu.
Faster.
La ve da me ni po tu.
Yeah, yeah. You reach kind of a, this is as fast as it can go.
If
yeah.
you go really fast, it's fioritura.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So the pattern is could lend itself, if you took it faster, it would really be an articulation thing more than anything. If you do it really slowly, la be da me, you know, it's very much creamy legato. So the tempo is a really fun thing to vary with an exercise. You can take one pattern and you could spend the whole little vocalizing session on one thing. Hey, let's do it this way. Let's do it this way. Okay, let's speed it up. Let's slow it down. I have a good friend. He'll do this pattern. La, be, da, me, ni, po, tu. And I've tried this. And then you do it. Be, da, me, ni, po, tu, la. And then you do it. Da, me, ni, po, tu, la, be. You keep shifting.
Okay, yeah.
So first you start on la, and you keep the same pattern of word, of syllables. And then you start on be, and you just loop around, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then you start on da.
Mm-hmm.
The pattern, I don't know who invented this pattern. It's probably 300 years old. The syllables, probably 300 years old. I'm not kidding. It goes way, 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 way back. And you can do all sorts of patterns with that one. You know, if you have that number of syllables, you know, you can do it. That you can come up with that has that number basic little units, you could put those words with. So, you know, it's just fun. It's fun. You can have all sorts of fun with it. Okay. It's all in how you use it. That's, I think, a big lesson about exercises. You know, I got a request from a former student here, and she wanted exercises for each voice type, and I said, oh, actually, we've been talking about that in class. And I gave her, you know, some sources from class. She says, I've been pulling out some of my old notes. And I said, you'll notice that there aren't any specific exercises here. It's how to look at the exercises, how to make up the exercises. But I'd rather not give you, here, use these, because every student's going to be individual. Just find, you know, you might have some basic patterns that you make variations on, but I was hesitant, and Dasha was the same way. People used to bug her, and they'd say, well, you know, Coffin made out a book, you know, and it has all these exercises in it, and Miller's book, and so on, and you know, why don't you, and she said,
"What's my name?"
No. She said, no, I'd rather not have people teach by a cookbook, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's great books out there, you know. I get out my Marchese book and my Liebling book and stuff. I look at those and I go, oh, well, that's a good pattern. How could I tweak that for so-and-so? So, anyway. All right, the next one is the fun one.
What is it?
Doesn't this phrase remind you?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, look, JD. What's that?
Yes,
yes.
And
my beans are all. just for old times' sake. At the beginning. What about it? What do you feel?
The vibration in your tongue.
Darn straight. And you feel them?
Behind your teeth.
Right there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So nice and forward. We like forward.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got a nasty old down there,
mm-hmm.
which is.
What did I write? I said the ah could be good for a singer who tends to over darken their low voice.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Because. Yeah, because that's what I saw. It's like immediately I was like, otherwise, why would you start with ah? But then I thought also about how both vowels are good for emphasizing the first formant, and that being both first formant vowels, they're really good for taking
ascending high. Oh, yeah.
So you could be.
You could take this exercise way on up.
I have had students where we took it up all, another octave from where that is. And a nice variation, of course, is da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You can do it legato or staccato at the end. Okay, so Sarah, speak to us about the pattern. Yeah, kind of builds that in with the vowels, you know, it's handy that you've got ah. But, you know, you mentioned one of the very key things. You've got legato, then staccato.
Mm-hmm.
This whole exercise is about shifting gears. Because
mm-hmm.
you go up, and then you go down. And you go legato, and you go staccato. And you have conjunct, ascending, and disjunct, descending. So it's all about making the switches. But that's what you got to do in music. If you sing any of the bel canto literature, you're doing this kind of stuff all the time. If you've got a mad scene or you're happy, you know, either of those emotions, which is pretty typical soprano emotions, you're either crazy or you're ecstatic. You know, oh, my lover's back, or I'm going to go crazy and I'm going to kill people with this knife, you know? There's not a whole lot of in between, unfortunately.
Or there's like what? I want to kill someone, or it's like, I want revenge, I'm insane, or I'm super happy because my lover.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Pretty much. Yeah. Yeah, that pretty well gets it. So, something you would like to add.
That this would be a good exercise to do later on.
I don't think I can do it. I think I put it on sideways. I was very sad.
It'd be very good to do.
To do later on.
Later on.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Not first thing, roll out of bed. Oh, I think I'll do that exercise. But but after you've been singing a while, and the same is true, you know, I've had good high school students, good high school sopranos, you know, seniors or something, who could do this, no problem. They could take it up. Oh my gosh, you know, about as high as I could play it, they could sing it, you know. And it was just light and oh, this is so fun. But it's not for a beginner, you know. Intermediate to advanced kind of student, you know. They've got to be able to sing a nice rapid scale and
it's a wide range.
Yeah, it is. It's a wide range. And, you know, keeping those staccati in tune, that leap down of the sixth there is like, whoop, and then up a fourth and then down another sixth, and then, you know,
it's kind of kooky. So.
It's helpful that it's all part of the same arpeggio, though.
Yeah. It's not like it modulated in between. Although that would be fun, wouldn't it? Okay. You could do a minor version too. Da 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 da. You could do a minor version.
Should totally do that.
In minor, I don't do anything in minor.
Yeah.
My son, just for fun, he you know, I mean, he's a typical gifted kid. You know, you hand them something and they go, oh, hey, let's mess with it this way. You know, so he's been working on a piano transcription of the William Tell. So the other day, I'm in there doing laundry, and I hear him making it minor. And he's playing it in minor, you know.
I do that to the Mozart.
She also does it to I'm a Little Teapot.
I'm a little teapot, short and small. Yeah, anyway. This is my handle. This is my sound. Yes. Well, anyway, so what about the muscles? What's.
I gotta finish it.
Oh, I know. What? Just tip me over and pour me out. Okay.
Yeah.
So.
Muscles. I don't write about it, but you begin, it's TA dominant in the very beginning.
Could be, yep.
And then, well, depending on where we are.
Well, if we were right there, yeah, probably.
And then we have to switch to the cricothyroid going boop, and then down back to TA, cricothyroid, TA.
Yeah.
TA.
I mean, not that we're ever at zero on either one of them, but just.
One has to have more dominance. You've got to switch those gears.
Yeah.
Pull, release, pull.
You know,
you pull.
Exactly. Yeah, you pull, I pull. What about the staccato portion? What's going on there?
As far as
muscle wise. Right? Because if we're doing staccati, adduct, abduct, adduct, abduct, as well as change length. Well, change length, adduct, change length, adduct. The way we've got it written with the big skips, which again is why it's more challenging than maybe the first one that we did. Because when you've got to negotiate pitch changes while you're not voicing, tricky business. Okay. We talked about in terms of relation to repertoire, something like this, a great study for the bel canto stuff. We talked about women doing it. Well, what about men? What about men? I mean, I can certainly sing it.
You change it to be more of to emphasize a different format.
Yeah. So
where you're doing it.
Yeah.
True.
You take it through your passaggio, and then you probably change it to
that O.
I'd probably do O. Yeah, I might do O if I went a half step higher. And if I got any higher than probably about an F, I'd probably say, can I do this legato instead of staccato? Because, you know, guys are not ever asked to do staccato things above in their passaggio and above.
Oh, what if you were training a castrati?
Oh, well.
But they're not actually a castrati.
Well, if you were training a counter.
Counter-tenor is what I meant to say.
If you were training a counter.
It's like, Melissa, where are you going to find one of those?
Yeah. If you were training a counter-tenor. You absolutely, you absolutely could use this, you know.
Because you'd want them to sound like a woman. You'd want them to emphasize
absolutely
the first formant.
Yep, you would train a countertenor, because I've worked with a couple. You would, you know, most of them are going to be essentially high lyric mezzos when they're singing that way. And so, same way I would work with a high lyric mezzo. I mean, I've got a friend in Las Vegas, good countertenor, and he sings comfortably up to about A, you know. I can sing a G sharp, you know. It's not the prettiest of notes, but I can sing the G sharp 5, Anyway, but yeah, you know, you could use these vowels for a countertenor, and for a baritone or something like that, you transpose it down. Yeah, you know, you could do it. Yeah, or you could do a legato version. And you could do O on the top, you could do ah on the top. Once you got past about D or D sharp, most guys, unless they're really high tenors, they're going to say, I don't want to do that ah up there. No, thank you. Okay. Anything else? Probably beaten that to death. Let's do the last. Let's sing it just so that we can enjoy its torture. Start in the middle this time, since we started on the ends. What you got?
Definitely something that I would give to more advanced students, just because of the amount of control needed. And also helps you figure out like your piano and your forte.
And everything in between.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Ooh, I didn't put it up there.
Nope. We're like, okay, come see if I can remember this. Okay.
So,
It's GC. And we hold it forever for Marta.
So, fermata, and we're doing a nice big, and then we do some of that.
Yeah.
Okay. So, what about breath management when we do this?
It's very challenging, but also I think the crescendo to the high note is good for helping singers that want to pull back when they go for a big sweep like that, and to support through the high note down.
Right, that's probably the toughest part of the mezzo di voce exercise. It's not the crescendo, it's the decrescendo. Because you're running out
you're
of
not
breath.
Going too fast.
You're running out of breath at the same time that you're having to, have the most control, you know. It's probably easier to drive with the brake on, you know, and gradually put gas on for the crescendo, but then to gradually ease back when you're going. Yeah.
Well, and I didn't put it in my thing, but I also was thinking about it. Decrescendo's on the way down, so you don't necessarily have to make as big of a change. It just sounds quieter. Based on where it is in your voice.
Yeah, that certainly helps. That certainly helps. As does, you've got the vowel change, which helps you, okay, I'm going to start in that small place, then I've got the more open vowel for my full, and then I've got the nice small vowel to come back to. And then hopefully you don't go, ooh, ah, you know, on the bottom note, which can happen. We've been there. Yes, 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 that clunk into chest. What would you do if you had somebody who tended to sing too dark? What might you suggest?
Yeah.
Huh?
You, yeah.
Yeah, you could use you, or even.
Even
E. Yeah, you could do. Absolutely, and this, yeah, again, would you do this rolling out of bed?
I put not too early,
not
warm
too
enough
early.
To finesse this.
Yes.
Not too late. You're too tired to
yeah.
finesse this.
So this is finesse singing. And I think there is great value once people get far enough along that you can start giving them something like this. I mean, and you could do it on a single note. You know, a good way to start teaching Messa di Voce. You know, you have them do a vowel sequence where they go from more closed to more open, back to closed. And then you could have them just have, you know, a single vowel where they do it. And then you might give them something like this. Another thing that's very helpful, for instance, I have a student right now that we've done a little Messa di Voce stuff, and what we do is we'll, you know, say single note and say we're doing it's a whole note. And so we do crescendo, takes breath, you know, okay, there's a phenomenon too. So taking a breath halfway, you do the crescendo, breathe, and then you do the decrescendo.
Oh, and then you've got to reocclude.
Well, and then, then, you know, and then you gradually say, okay, let's take that breath out.
Mm-hmm.
So approximations to the goal. You might do the E-A-A-O-O thing, and then maybe E-A somewhere, and then you do something like that, and then finally you do one with no bridge. Yes.
Something I learned was, I don't know how to spell Messa di Voce.
Double S.
Okay, good, because I wrote many
Messa.
Different
yeah.
types.
Uh-huh, because it is the verb mettere,
mm-hmm. okay.
to put or to place. And so literally Messa di Voce is placing of the voice, you know.
Nice.
And it was one of those finishing exercises that teachers used historically. Because it's really, if you can do a good Messa di Voce, then you've obviously got internal control of your laryngeal muscles pretty well worked out. Because when you get louder, you use more breath pressure, you probably ramp up your TA a little bit, because that's one of the ways we get louder, is you stiffen your vocal folds, literally, you know. And you maybe adduct a little more. So it's a real mark of the artistry of a singer if they can have that dynamic control, breathing-wise and laryngeally, and what do you have to do to the vowel? You start with it more closed, and you've got to open it when you go to more loud, and then vice versa. So it's vowel modification, breath management, and control in the box, you know? So it is really, it's really a great exercise. Every advanced singer, I think, every day, you should do a little Messa di Voce and you should do some staccato, because that's fine control of your larynx and your breathing. If you've got those two things going for you, you can sing most music that gets thrown your way. And I think doing something legato with consonants, it would be a third one. So if you had, remember Thomas Hauser, you know, what do I do, Moishe, you know? Okay, so, if you had three exercises, okay, I have time to do three exercises. Something legato in my mid-range with some consonants. So I'm working on, you know, something that moves you throughout your range and maybe has some running notes or some staccatos in it. And then a third thing would be something with dynamic control required. Because those are kind of key. All right. And then on to the music. Why are we doing this? It's not to be, you know, a great track athlete. It's to be a singer, to sing words and move people. Okay, shall we move on? Speaking of moving. All right, so shall I pick those things up? All right. So, talking about teaching pronation, right?
I'm remembering she's first.
You are first.
Okay.
So.
Do we get to stand?
Knowing the difference between glottal onset, soft onset, and balanced onset, and being able to do it just in speech before you sing.
Mm-hmm.
And so I want everyone to practice first glottal, although if you've noticed a student glottals a lot and needs to work more on soft, then you can start with soft.
Mm-hmm.
But I've started. So I want you to imagine that you're watching one of those terrible compilation videos of like the skateboarders hurting themselves really, really bad.
Okay.
And you do the oh kind of thing.
Oh.
With like the really like oh.
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 Or maybe if it's a particularly feisty young female student, you could maybe do a scenario like you're arguing with your parents and you want to go out to this party and they're telling you no, and you say, I'm going.
I'm
going.
And you forcefully,
I,
and you feel that.
I'm going.
You hear,
yeah. I'm
going.
I'm going.
I'm going. I'm going. Okay, so glottal, and then of course, we will sort of juxtapose that with like ho.
Ho.
Ho. Oh.
Oh.
Ho.
Ho.
Ho. Oh. Uh-oh.
Yeah.
That's a good one. Yes. Those are the words you'll know. Come running when you hear that and a crash.
Oh,
well.
And then also I think it's good sometimes for like students that need sort of like a physical thing to do like this and to know like when you say,
ho.
Ho.
Or
oh.
Oh. And you
oh.
Press. You press.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Oh.
Oh.
Or oh.
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 Balance. Oh.
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 That's good. That's good. And you're teaching them something about this is sort of what it looks like.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Groovy.
Yay.
I like it.
And so you can do all sorts of different different like combinations of things like that and model it a lot for your students
mm-hmm.
until
mm-hmm.
they understand. Because sometimes it really takes a while for it to sink in. And then we sing.
And then we sing.
So I really like the staccato.
But they'd be trying to achieve
yeah.
balanced
and
for the onsets? Okay.
Yeah, and the more that you do it and you let your body just repeat the motion, the more you kind of start to figure it out. So you can start maybe with five.
Mm-hmm.
And of course descending is good for
mm-hmm.
for that coordination, bringing this CT head voice sort of production down
mm-hmm.
into chest voice,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to starting with the really speaky guttural thing that tends to happen. And then when they start to get it more with five, then you can take it down to three.
Mm-hmm.
And then eventually you just use those practices and concepts in all of the exercises you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I like that you've got, you know, the staccato followed by a little scale, because
mm-hmm.
what you want them to generalize is that that they're sustaining
mm-hmm.
is the same good coordination that
mm-hmm.
they have on the little brief ones.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah.
Otherwise, they kind of miss the train.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think also it's important for them to know and for you to explain that, like, you want balanced onset most of the time you're singing,
mm-hmm.
but you have to be able to do all three.
Yeah.
Have to be able to pronounce
that's a good
H.
point.
Yeah.
And you have to
you don't
be
want
able
them to be afraid of
yeah. and
doing those
and
things.
When you're singing in English, you
or
need
German.
To glottal.
Or
yeah.
German.
Or German.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
For the text to be
ah. Ah. focus you need. You need
to.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Good.
Your turn.
Someone else. Charlie, would you like her? No.
Go.
Why don't you go?
Okay. So do you remember when we last time when we were exhibiting phonation, the types of phonation? Well, I just cut that and pasted.
Rebooted.
Pasted it in the beginning.
Yeah.
Just to talk about phonation, and we, you know, show the vocal apparatus, point out what it does, and then we do the different types. First is all air, no sound. You repeat after me. Yeah. Next was breathy. You're Marilyn Monroe. All right, and then we do our flow. So you just speak. Very good. Normal. Speak like a normal human being.
Speak like a normal human being.
Very nice. And then pressed. You're Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Let's get to the chopper. Come with me if you want to live. Come with me if you want to live.
So you'll do that.
You're a girly man.
And point out, this does not feel nice. This does not feel nice. And then, of course, there's no air, no sound, which is
Vasalva.
You close so hard, like when you try to poop.
Yeah, that's the Vasalva, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, and then I've got, let's talk about onsets. And what I had under there is they set you up for success, so that's something important to remember, so repeat after me. Onsets set you up for success.
Onsets set you
up
for
success.
Yes. Okay, and so the difference between them is that phonation is a continuum. Onsets are the fresh-faced beginning for the continuum. And then I had some examples. So you've got a student who has breathy phonation. Who wants to be breathy lady?
I can be breathy.
Hey,
I want to be breathy.
All right, then I got you can bet it starts with the onset. So I got some examples. Try to get physical feedback by having the student place their hand in front of their mouth while singing ah on a comfortable pitch. Do you feel that puff of air?
Yeah.
Yeah, right before
mm-hmm.
you sing? Good, good. Do you feel like you use a lot of air really fast?
Oh, I can't. I have to breathe all the time.
Try one more time.
I have to breathe all the time. I just run out of breath so fast.
Does that sound like a lot of H's to you?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So we're going to get audible feedback, and I have them get out their phone. Everybody's got a phone. And then we have them listen to it after they've been physical with it. We play it back immediately, and then I'll demonstrate again. And then you'll copy me. Better, better. One more time. Very nice. And then there's a vocalese for the onset problem if you want one. And then I did. This was mine too.
Are you doing the little replenish or just a release?
Whichever you like. You can breathe in between if you want. And then if this proves troublesome, add a consonant. Something voiced.
Something voiced, yep.
And then student who has press phonation. Who wants to be pressed? Come here, Arnold. You can bet it starts with the onset. So too much air and too much pressure on them chords. You may want to begin by adding consonants to the vocalese immediately. So we'd start with a... Really focus on your v. Nice. Okay, and it may be helpful to have them speak for you. So I want you to say apples, eggs, a, like you're Canadian, ears, oh dear, and oops.
Apples, eggs.
Ears. Oh dear.
Oh dear.
And oops.
Oops.
Okay, so a lot of those are natural glottals. You didn't overdo them. That's something you want to pay attention to and think about. And then, so I'd listen and evaluate. And then we'd demonstrate the balance onset, have you repeat, and record for immediate feedback.
Yeah.
That's what I got.
Yay. Y'all can have a seat. Because we'll be wrapping up. Yeah. So. I liked you guys going from speech because a lot
lot of their habits are probably speech-based.
Mm-hmm.
Or they're certainly going to be reinforcing whatever habits, you know, more in their speech than in their singing. So
mm-hmm.
very often, yeah, you know, the person who has the pressed stuff, you know, you give them sentences that are H's, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You may, if they are really pressed, you're going to have to take them way the other way. You know, happy Halloween. Hi, Harold.
Happy Hanukkah.
Happy Hanukkah.
Hartford.
Yeah. And
oh,
then
in Hartford, Hedford, and Hampshire.
Yes.
Hurricanes hardly happened.
Yes. And so, yeah, you know, and in fact, speech pathologists, they'll have a whole page full of, they'll have HQ words. They'll have, you know, keywords that are all in it, they all start with H, and then some sentences. And then you might move from that, sequencing that, to then they would probably do some things with nasals. My mother, you know, or the voice fricatives. I don't know, you know, V's and C's and zesty zithers.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the
city. And that one has lots of different kinds of consonants. But, you know, so the pressed person, which honestly in our day and age is more common than the breathy one. I tend to feel if it's basically okay, don't fuss with it,
yeah.
You know?
It's fine, don't fuss.
Right, because sometimes you encounter teachers who are like, abduct or die, you know? and generally, what tends to happen then is people start recruiting their TA, because it is a secondary abductor,
mm-hmm.
You know?
They do it as a
really?
Oh, that's what you
I would have never known.
Sick bird.
No, because I would volunteer.
They use a lot of pride.
I would, they would make
she volunteered
me do that.
To be one of their lesson guinea pigs.
Of course, they had a really hard time with me because they couldn't start at the beginning.
She's doesn't.
So they would do that. I'm like, why are we doing this? This is hurting me. I never
yeah.
said anything because I wasn't.
Yeah. You're like, I can do this.
I mean, a little sparing use of vocal fry with an adult. I would not use it with a young one, you know. But somebody who's 22 or 23 and they are still on the breathy side,
mm-hmm.
You know, I might say, okay, we're going to do some things like, you know, where you drop in and out of fry. Or, you know, I wrote an article about using vocal fry. Kate Emmerich and Ingo and I wrote an article about using fry, but it's all a matter of getting a person back to balance. And you know, if they're overpressed, then you want to unload whatever muscles are overworking. If they're underdoing, you know, staccatis and the spoken, you know, words that ask and I, you know, uh-oh, you know, where they feel, okay, there's just a little more bite to it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They start, and then you can pair it up with words that have an age on set, and you have to help them understand that they don't need to overdo the unvoiced. Dosher used the TH, unvoiced TH would be too much, and
mm-hmm.
towards the end, she realized, and we were taking out the consonants because I was overdoing the unvoiced fricatives.
Mm-hmm.
But it's all a matter of getting that balance. So again, you know, if a person is doing pretty well, I wouldn't mess with it a whole lot. You know, you can design exercises that get them to sing out more, or you use staccatos or bounced things, and it takes care of itself. So, you know, I would just tread very carefully. Yeah.
What would you recommend for a student who appears advanced but don't know how they're achieving what they're achieving? Like, they've got a natural gift, a natural knack for singing.
Mm-hmm.
So you're like, oh, maybe I don't have to explain these things, but then later they get into voice lessons in college, and all of a sudden they have to figure out exactly how they're doing things,
yeah.
And all of a sudden there are problems.
Yeah.
What do you
right.
do?
Well, it's always good when you see the person who just, I don't know, I just sing. know, well, what goes on? Just ask them, you know. So what do you feel when you do that? And you can get a sense of how much are they aware of, how much do they know. You don't want to impede them with too much thinking, but you do have to get them aware of what they're doing, I think. And certainly as a teacher, you know, watch them like a hawk. Okay, they do some things really, really well, which lets them get away with murder in some other areas.
Mm-hmm.
They can always make a pretty sound, but they may be kind of killing themselves to make this pretty or big or whatever sound.
That's what I do with Obama.
I mean, I was judging the Allstate auditions in New Mexico. They have a traveling team, and you go around all these different cities, and all the kids come to the school, and you hear like 200 kids. But anyway, and I heard these boys, there were a couple of these boys from this one school, and I mean, they had, well, to the naive person, it was like, God, what a voice. I'm here and sitting there going, he's 17 years old, and he's trying to sound like he's 30, and he just stepped on the stage of the Met. Like, a 17-year-old can't do that without manufacturing like crazy. You know, and the minute I heard it, within 10 seconds, it was like, this is either God's gift or this is someone manufacturing a big sound to be impressive. And the more I watched and the more I listened, I said, this is manufacturing. And I wrote that in my comments. And, you know, sorry. I'm not fooled. I love your big sound. Let's get it correct.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So there is some of that, too. And
like,
I think...
that's lovely. Do you have any idea how I did that?
Yeah.
Do
yeah.
What? I just opened my mouth.
Well, and there is a certain amount of don't screw up what they do naturally.
Yeah.
But as you said, you know, there comes a point in someone's development where that isn't enough.
Yeah.
They need more than just what they intrinsically kind of do. You need to help them, because there's some things with breathing that we do that are just not terribly natural. You know, it is not natural to breathe in slowly and stay
expanded.
You know, expanded, keeping your external intercostals while you phonate. That is not something we do in any other thing but speaking and singing.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, even the greatest of actors have studied speech training. But yeah.
So, a number of my students, and it's like the more I listen to the radio and they're bringing these songs to me that they want to sing, the more I'm realizing that a lot of these singers that they hear on the radio have a very aspirate, breathy sound
mm-hmm.
through their whole song. So,
mm-hmm.
like, for example, I had a girl last night, and she does not have a breathy speaking voice at all. And then she started singing her song for me, and I started to get real worried because I was hearing something not quite right.
Yeah.
I was afraid that we weren't having complete adduction going on. And
how old is she?
She's in eighth grade.
Well, you don't have complete adduction going on.
But it was weird for her because she doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
I don't normally hear this out of her,
mm-hmm.
but then all of a sudden, it was more so.
Mm-hmm.
So I talked to her, you know, about onset and had her, you know, first identify them in me and then
mm-hmm.
have her do them.
Mm-hmm.
And then she felt it and she could do better onsets, but mm-hmm. it seems to be the trend with most of my students that they're like, they come in and they're like, how are you doing? And they start singing, they're all over the place.
Yeah.
And I don't know.
Well,
I guess I'm having a hard time telling them not to sing like what they hear on the radio.
Right.
That's
well, I mean, one
be.
Of the things you can say is realize that that person has a microphone right there and a sound engineer who can do anything,
mm-hmm.
literally anything with that voice.
Which is why when you hear like Ellie Goulding,
mm-hmm.
when you listen to her sing on the radio, you're like, oh, okay. But then I know people who've seen her in concert, you can't hear her, even with microphones and
oh,
stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, she's up on stage, you cannot hear her. She's so soft.
So, I guess it depends on what their aspirations are and what kind of music they want to sing. I mean, there are people who do nothing but teach people who want to be in commercial music. And there is a way that you can sing with that breathy sound. You can still teach someone good breathing and good body alignment and vowel stuff and articulation things, you know. And I would suggest that you
you know, if you can convince them, it's important that you have a variety of ways of producing the sound, that you can do the clear and you can do the breathy, you know, that you can do the more intimate and yet you can also do something a little more clear or intense or whatever. Because
you're deciding if you could do it all.
Well, then you're giving them more tools in their toolbox to play with, to be more expressive with. And if you can sell them on the expressive side of it, they'll buy into the technique. That has been my experience when I work with popular singers, and you show them, give them